We made it. Like in lots of ways, everybody, we made it. Welcome today, and thank you for having me here. I will talk fast. It is raining hard. This is such a Portland day. It's just classic. I am a little startled and very, very happy to say that this marks my 20th year in recovery from eating disorders. Weird, right? My 20th year of daily making the choice to live a different kind of life. 2 decades of a growing faith that recovery can be done. It is no longer a question in my mind if recovery is possible. It is an absolute conviction and a life-giving faith. Recovery can happen, does happen every day, because we choose it, because we take the journey through it, because we make it real. In the 20 years since I stepped out of the mirror and into what seemed a very strange, very new, extremely frightening world, years I did not think I'd live to see. I have been given gifts, support, inspiration, and grace that I could not have imagined when I was sick and would not have believed. I believed back then that the best I could hope for was maybe a little improvement, maybe enough to keep me alive for a while. But I believed that ultimately the eating disorder would take me down. It did not. I believed that I was helpless to stop it, a hopeless case. I was not. I believed that eating disorder recovery was an oxymoron. I believed that none of us had a chance against this thing. I could not have been more wrong. Today, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that recovery happens. It is not merely a word. It is not an abstract concept. It is an action. It is a choice, one that any one of us has the capacity to make. I know recovery is a possibility that lies within each of us who have struggled or who still struggle with disordered eating. No matter where we are at any given moment, no matter how strong a hold the disorder may have on us or how strongly we are holding on to it, I know that we can break free and I know that we can let go. I have faith in recovery, an unshakable faith. Recovery is not a wish, a dream, a maybe someday, maybe partway sort of thing. Recovery is a reality. Recovery is a fact. And it is there for the taking. We are here today to walk. We may be just beginning our journey. We may be well on our way. But we are here to walk together, to do the work together. We are making the choice together today to have hope. And there is work to do for each of us. There is the effort of the journey toward health, and there is the steadily growing strength we develop as we take this walk. Each of us will find ourselves navigating a path that is rough in places. We will face challenges that seem insurmountable at first. There will be days when we want to quit, turn around, head back into the known world of illness and obsession, climb back into the cage where we've lived a long time. But we can't, so we don't. There will be days when we want to sit down in the middle of our road and sob. We can, and sometimes we do, and that's fine. So we sob for a while, and then we pick ourselves up and walk on. There are things we have in common. We share a common goal. We want our lives back. We want freedom from obsession and from that breathtaking, soul-crushing fear. We want to thrive and not just survive. We know that there is more for us, more that we want to live for, much more that we want to do. And we are reaching for that life. For freedom, for joy, reaching past the limits we placed on ourselves, opening the cage in which we've been trapped, and walking out. And so the journey begins. Now, we no longer need to apologize for ourselves, for taking up space, for talking too loud, for breathing the air, for loving and healing our bodies, for laughing or for crying, for asking for help, for throwing out shame, and for saying, finally, this. I am here. This is the new life I want. This is the beautiful life I deserve, and I get to have it because I said so. It is mine. It is not the property of illness. It is not the property of the past. It's mine. And as we walk, we hold nothing back. For healing to take place, we have to heal every aspect of ourselves, our bodies, our spirits, our hearts, and our minds. And there are things that we have to accept. There are some trade-offs when we let go of illness and take up health. As frightening as that is, we have to consider, what have I already given away? What have I sacrificed to stay sick? Where have I compromised my deepest beliefs in order to appease the illness that was trying to take my life? I can't speak for you, but I gave up everything I had. Every dream, every goal, every deeply held value, every person I loved. I gave up strength and independence and freedom. I gave up the life I wanted to live. And in order to get those things back, I had to open my hands and let go. I had to let go of fear in order to take hold of courage. I had to let go of the obsession that was destroying my mind if I ever hoped to use my mind again. I had to let go of the values that had come to replace things I really believed in, really loved, in order to know my true beliefs and feel true love again. A love without limits, without hiding, without lies. I had to give up every symptom, not some. And I had to let go of the vice grip that I held on my belief that safety lay in sickness, where true safety, true freedom is part and parcel of health. So there is work, there are trade-offs, there are things to let go, but what we get in return is recovery, not in part, but in full. One of our most pressing tasks as recovering people is this: we need to build community. We have spent so long in isolation or in the context of people who didn't support our recovery. One of the gifts of recovery is that we no longer have to be alone. In fact, recovery depends in great part on our willingness to connect, to rebuild our relationships, to take part in the living world. We have spent enough time torn apart from the people that we need and who need us. We often forget that we have gifts of our own beyond measure and that those gifts are meant to have impact on the world. One of the ways that we can have that impact is by forming a community of recovering people who exist to support one another, to bear witness to the possibility of healing, who show each other how it can be done, who bring laughter to dark places in each other's lives and comfort through tears, and who do not compete anymore. We do not need the competition. We know this is a life of matter and death, and so we have got to reject the terrifying competition for who is best at this endgame. Reject it in ourselves and in each other, and take up instead compassion, connection, love, laughter, wonder at the fact that we have made it and now have the chance to live again. Wonder at the fact that it was our choice all along. We need a community that helps us build the courage that our journeys require. And we need a community because we live in a culture that does foster this illness and that does not always support healing and health. We need to be a force against our culture's fear and obsession. We need to be a safe haven for people in recovery. We need to rise above the noise of the world to hear our own clear voice and to hear that voice reminding us again and again of our choice. Today, I do not question the choice I made to recover, a choice I made years ago and that I make again every day. But at first, I was racked with fear, with doubt that it would ever get better, that it would ever be easier, that I would ever really recover, that I could ever be free. I felt like I was stuck between two choices I couldn't make. I knew I could not go on living as I was, but I did not believe I could change. I did not feel inspired to recover. I did not feel even slightly ready. I felt hopeless. And the loss of hope is a soul sickness and a grief unlike any I have ever known. But this is what I know. Hope is never truly, fully snuffed out. It lives on, even as we clutter our minds and our spirits and our lives with the noise of obsession. Even then, hope is there, unfailingly patient, and it waits for us to dig deep into who we really are, deeper down than the eating disorder, deeper than the illness, deeper, deeper down, until we reach someone who does have hope. Where does hope live? Where do we find it in ourselves? Every one of us here today has at least a little, maybe a flicker of hope that it could be better, maybe a clear, strong hope that it will. So how do we hold on to it with the strength and inner power we used so long against ourselves? How do we hold and cultivate hope rather than fear? We let go of the bars of the cage to which we cling, and we open the door. And then how do we move forward from hope to faith? Faith that there is freedom to be had. Faith that fear lessens and then leaves. Faith that the burden we've carried for so long will fall from our shoulders and allow us to go on with our lives. How do we find not just hope, but faith that there is a journey ahead for us, and we are strong enough to walk it, and we are brave enough to leave behind the known past and go forward into the unknown future where we need to live? The East Indian poet Rabindranath Tagore wrote, "Faith is the bird that feels the light when the dawn is still dark." This morning, as I write these words, it is still dark. But I know the light will come. I can feel it. I know it because I have seen it. I know dawn to be a fact. And with equal certainty, I know healing to be a fact because I have seen it. Again and again, I have seen healing take place. It requires willingness. It requires acceptance. It requires connection, laughter, wonder, support. It requires work, and it is not always an easy road to walk. But it is our road. These are our lives. This is our journey. Let's walk.